Of the whole year, You know, and then Palm Sunday, and then we head on into Holy Week. And, you know, it is, when we look around our world, it is no wonder that we are in the mess that we're in, that the world is in the shape that it's in, because most of the world, including probably most of us inside of the Orthodox Christian faith, do not know these things, do not live these things. You know, we have quite a stark example for us in what's been going on politically, if you want to call it that. I suppose that it wouldn't be called a political thing by many, with the march for your life, march for our life, that was going on down in Washington. One of the thoughts that would cross my mind is how many of those would be the same people who were also marching in the Women's March on Washington. You know, and what kind of an interesting kind of cross-section and overflow or overlapping of what people believe, because I'm not sure of any or too many of the people who would be down there really know why they're there. In days past, if we were living back in Byzantium, you know, which is was certainly not any kind of golden era of humanity, nonetheless, as a Christian culture, when things went wrong, what did they do? They took to the streets also, but they would have taken to the streets and circled the city in procession with the icons and the holy images and singing hymns, crying out to God. And where do we go? You know, our young people, they cry out to Congress. You know, they cry out to our lawmakers. What a sad thing. No wonder we see the kinds of responses from them that we do. No wonder we see young people deciding that the best thing they can do is get a gun and take some people down to have made their mark somehow so that someone noticed that they were on the planet. And that's what the problem is, my brothers and sisters, that we all want to be recognized and acknowledged. And in this world, it just doesn't happen. We see that what's happened is an increasing fragmentation, a breaking down of even what we used to simply call civility, of good manners, of how we operated with each other. And we know now that we take to the street and we demand, and it's a strange kind of demand, I mean, given that there is no way that any of us are able to ascertain for ourselves security, certainty. I mean, what should we march against next? Shall we march against cancer? Why don't we do that? I think there are marches like that. But maybe if we got a little bit more agitated about it, maybe then, you know, something would happen in that realm. But it doesn't, because we're crying out to all the wrong places. We're crying out anywhere we can imagine or look at where we think that maybe something can be done. But we avoid or we miss the one place where something can truly be done. Because, you know, again, 100 years from now, how many of us will still be alive? Maybe they'll be extending our lives. You know, maybe the cry for medicine, we live in a wonderful part of the country, for, you know, UPMC and all the cutting edge kinds of things. Oh, we'll probably see many, many people doing really well at 100 years. You know, having had organs replaced and joints replaced, little might be recognizable of them, but we will probably be able to live. But will we have accomplished anything great in doing that? And maybe we'll even get to another planet, so that when this one wears out, we'll be able to get to another planet, perhaps, so that the human race can continue. For what? You know, for what? What is the end game here? What is our goal? And unless we're looking someplace a little bit higher than to ourselves and to our science and to our body politic for the answers, things are not going to get any better. Because the only place they really do get to either get worse or improve, really, is right in here. And so as I was listening to that hymn this morning, you know, wondering, in a foolish kind of wondering, how did I get so fortunate? You hear me say these kinds of things. How did I get to be a person who gets to be bathed in the kind of beautiful words about what's real as we do in our Orthodox Christian faith? Nobody. other religion, no other philosophy, gets poured out into them all the time, these glorious ideas, hymns, notions, visions, dreams, whatever we want to call them, of what is really real. Nobody else gets this. And so the sadness comes because we who have been given all these things and who now, 40 years after the time when most of it was in some foreign tongue, can now be procured by us virtually for nothing when we get on the internet. We're able to do and to see these things that other people are noticing. And in many cases, we're still not. Because for those of us especially who were raised in what was an Orthodox kind of setting, in churches that look very much like these, we simply have the disadvantage of what happens when we are so used to something that we just don't even notice what we have. And as that old saying goes, that you know, you don't notice what you had until it's gone, we are watching it go. We are watching the result of what happens when piety and love depart from civilization. We're seeing it all deteriorate and fall apart. And the good news for that there is that we get to get to work. And how do we do it? It starts in a very simple sort of fashion. Not to say that there aren't many approaches that can be taken, but the one that the church gives us starts with the word repent. And repent simply meaning, notice that what you're doing has not exactly been on track. That you're headed in the wrong direction. That your thinking is upside down. That if you're thinking at all, maybe it's simply a matter of needing to wake up. However we might want to see it, it begins right where we are. And that is why, during times of year like this, although certainly not constrained to this time, and also recommended that we be doing this on a daily basis, we repent and we confess our sins. And in order to do that, we have to look and see what they are. We have to examine who we are and our consciences and our behaviors and how we've been doing. And as beings who are called today to recognize this path to our salvation being open up, are we running that race down that path? Are we looking to actually be growing, to be changing, to be transformed, to be illumined, to be transfigured into what Adam lost and recovered in Christ, which is our divine nature, not by nature, but by grace. That's what's given. And there will be nothing that will happen to us in this world, whether we live in the best of times or in the worst of times, that can change that. In fact, the worst of times end up being perhaps a little bit more motivating to us. But whether they be the best or the worst of times, whether our health be as good as we would like it or not, whether our finances be as fine as we would like them to be or not, whether our houses and our neighborhoods and the places where we work are as good as we would like them to be or not is totally irrelevant to these things. Totally irrelevant. Makes no difference at all except in the way we roll them around in our heads. Because the bottom line is all of us need to hit our knees and repent of taking hardly any notice of the things that are really real. So where do we begin? Can we throw up our hands and say, I'm too old, it's too late for me? Well, some of us might do that. Can we say that, well, you know, I'm too old and my habits are just too deeply ingrained? Some of us might say that. And so we're given examples. We're given that really good example, which in a couple weeks we get to look at Christ on the cross and see who's up there with them. And notice that there's a thief there who, at the very end, did not, as his friend across the way said, you know, kind of too late for us, either get us down from here or on you. But that's not what we get to do. Not if we're Christians. Not if we're really understanding what it means when we call Jesus our Lord and Savior. Brothers and sisters, we have the opportunity all the time, again, in hard times more so than ever, to do the repenting that is essential. There is no progress, no growth of my soul without repentance. There is no movement from where I find myself stuck, or from where I can look and see that I've been stuck virtually all my life. There's no movement from there without saying, God, save me. And that's all of these feasts are about. Whether it be, again, you know, we get this week, we get next Saturday, we get next Sunday, then we get glorious pasta. And sometimes in all the wonder, you know, as we're preparing or not preparing that much, you know, we have had so little opportunity to a full choir practice that it will be an interesting thing to come to church and see what happens when we sing the responses. But I'll tell you one thing about it. I know that I've had an opportunity to really look a little harder at what I do at Easter time. Because you know what I worry about every year is, what am I going to do up here? You know, do I know my moves? You know, have I read the script once again to make sure that I know what I'm supposed to be doing and when I'm supposed to be doing it? And you know what? That's really dark too. Because it's easy to miss the glory and wonder of just being alive when trying to do a service right, you know? And as much as, you know, I lose a little sleep if I'm going to be, you know, once again, as at Christmas time, you know, be waving my hands and trying the best that I can do to have our singing be somehow acceptable. At the same time, you know, even the most glorious of our singing, you know, in the most beautiful times and places that Orthodoxy has ever lived, are nothing compared to the splendor and glory of the love that God has for us. So as we move forward, as we look at these things, as we consider these things, as we hear the hymns of the church, as we either come to church or don't come to church, let us at least make the attempt to be going a little bit deeper this year, to be paying a little bit more attention, to be recognizing that culture as I've known it, life as I've known it, has had virtually nothing to do with what I will take with me when I leave this world. And I know that I'm closer, obviously, than I was when I first began to leaving this world. And so I pray for myself and I pray for all of us that we really get serious, that we take these things to heart, that we recognize that the things that we're so concerned with and lose so much sleep and energy and worry so much about are going to be vanishing, gone. And then what's left? That's what this is all about. What's left when we are all gone. Let us pray that as we go through these wonderful feast days, and as we will head toward the commemoration and walking the road of Christ through his passion, let us pray that we will do so at another level, you know, from a different place, from a place that we've never been before. Because if life is not about going to places that we've never been before, then we're really not paying much attention. Amen.